Namaskaram. In the story of Saraswati Sindhu Hindu civilization, which we will be covering in a number of episodes, we have so far covered three topics. One is Samudra Manthanam, which is a narrative of the resources of the rivers, oceans, mountains, environment, geography and polity, referring to the terrain and the resources offered by the plains and the foothills of the Himalayas, which facilitates agriculture in alluvial soil. And we were looking at the trade as a very major activity of the people of the civilization across a very extensive area. Now we will try to see how the wealth of nations is created. As you know, Adam Smith wrote a very beautiful book, which is considered the pioneering work on economics, Wealth of Nations. In this remarkable book, he accounts for four major factors of economic activity which result in wealth. The four activities are, or categories are, one, land, two, labor, three, capital, four, organization. Land refers to the resources of the type we have seen. Labor, artisans who work and create products with their technological competence and skills, which result in the tradable commodities. So land, labor, then capital. That is, initial activity requires some investment of getting across to the equipment that is needed for the artisans to function, or the farmers to function, for the artists to produce their works of art. So those resources refer to the capital that is required to start off the economic activity. And the fourth is the organization, how the people are organized together as a composite group for a common objective of achieving productive activity, enterprise. So land, labor, capital, organization contribute to the creation of the wealth of nations. Okay, this is the thesis he posited, and this is validated by the evidence that we get from the indescript corpora of more than 8,000 inscriptions, which have been produced in four volumes so far with very beautiful photographic imagery, and more volumes are yet to come. But we have got a good handle on about 9,000 inscriptions of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization using the medium of indescript of Melha language. Now we will start the narrative of the wealth of nations from a very remarkable metaphor, which is seen on a Kuntala Panchmark coin of 600 before Common Era. Kuntala is an area near Sahyadri Mountains, near Belgaum in Karnataka. And the second component we will see is the Ganda Berunda tradition, which is dated to and originates from about 2500 before Common Era. So this is the Hindu civilization story of Ganda Berunda. The Kuntala Panchmark coin links with the iron ore wealth and Ganda Berunda tradition from about 2500 before Common Era, traces to Bogaska in Mitanni, also links up with iron ore wealth. Both Kuntala Panchmark coin and the Ganda Berunda tradition herald the iron ore wealth of the Sahyadri Ranges, Western Ghats, ancient Bharat, India. This is the picture of the Kuntala Panchmark coin, where three hieroglyphs are combined together. One is a dotted circle, second is a pulley, and the third is a trefoil, and it is punched in. And as you can see from the map, Kuntala is located near the Sahyadri Range iron ore mines, and the map shows the iron ore wealth of Bharat and the Sahyadri Ranges in the ranges near Orissa, Rourkela, then Bokaro, Bengal Bihar coalfields, Jamshedpur. They are the richest iron ore mines in the world. It's a very major contributor as a resource, the land, for as a resource of the mines contributing to the wealth of the nation. Now, look at the pulley. See, the pulley is shown on the coin, and the three pulleys joined together create a multiplication factor of a force of threefold force. So, a heavy article can be lifted up. And the heavy article they were referring to is iron ore, iron ingots. Iron was in use in approximately 2000 before Common Era in southern India. Pulleys were used in Egypt in about 1900 before Common Era. The Kuntala coin is a composition of a hypertext with Indus-script hieroglyphs. Kuntala is evidenced in an inscription of Talagunda inscription called near Belgavi, and it refers to Balligavi, Valli Gramam, Valli associated with Skanda. Skanda as the Senapati controlling the resources and armories of the Ganas and the guilds. So the Balligavi or Belgaum and the nearby regions are parts of Kuntala. Inscriptions in Kobataru near Anavati mention Kobataru as the Kuntala Nagara. Kuntala is revered as one of the three great countries of Chalukya period inscriptions. Valli Grame Belgaum was called Balligavi. The region is close to Sahyadri range, iron ore mines, wealthy mines, wealth of the country. Now look at, let us take a look at, deeper look at the three hieroglyphs. Dotted circle, trefoil, pulley. Dotted circle is a hypertext composed of two hieroglyphs. A dot, dai, and vatta, circle. They are read rebus as dhatu, mineral ore, plus vatti, brath, vritti, trade and business. Thus together, the dotted circle signifies dhavad, iron smelter, dhatu vritta. The trefoil hieroglyph refers to three mineral ores of iron, hematite, laterite, magnetite. These are dhavu, dhav, soft red stones. Hence the expression is tridhatu, three mineral ores. The next is the third one, the pulley hieroglyph. Gira, gero is a pulley. Garra means stone. Gar means stone. Thus the pulley signifies iron ore stones of the Sahyadri ranges. So the mint coin from Kuntala is referring to the wealth resource of iron ore that they are working with in the mint. This Belagavi is such a phenomenal tradition in our Hindu history. Belgaum, near Sahyadri Ranges, Western Ghats, is also famous for an iron pillar. We know of the iron pillar in Delhi. There is an iron pillar in Belgavi. And that temple of that iron pillar also had Ganda Berunda sculpture, a double eagle, anthropomorphized as a human being. And we will demonstrate that this anthropomorphic composition of two-headed eagles of a warrior, a hero, dates to Bogaskai Bitani of the 3rd millennium before Common Era. Look at the pictures. Look at the iron pillar. And this Ganda Berunda statue was supposed to be mounted on top of this pillar. It was fallen apart and it's kept separately near the pillar today. The double eagle tradition goes back to the seals of Bogaskai of 2500 before Common Era. They are Indus-script hieroglyphs showing the presence of Meluha artisans in Bogaskai Bitani, ancient Near East, in 3rd millennium before Common Era. When one seal, two eagles are shown together with a hair. It's a seal of Bogaskai. They are in Indus-script Meluha hieroglyphs. So this demonstrates Meluha speakers who wrote Indus-script wealth accounting ledgers had moved into Bogaskai about 2500 before Common Era. The same artisans from Belagavi had moved there. One seal of Bogaskai, now in the Ankara Museum, shows two eagles and a hare. Kara, hare. Rebus, car, blacksmith. Siena, eagle. Siena Chiti, Siena fire altar. Evidence of that has been found in Uttarakashi, Bharat, Uttarakhand. Siena, eagle. Ashani, thunderbolt. Ahangar, blacksmith in Pashto language. Ahan, iron. Ahangar, smith, blacksmith. Ahangaran, plural. Ahan Ruba, magnet or lodestone. Ahan Ruvabi Vashtu. Another seal of Bhagaskaya shows a double eagle together with a twist. Twist hieroglyph is Medha. A twist signifies made, done, yagna, iron. This is commented on by Yaska in Nigantuka. This is a quintessential Indo-script hieroglyph. The circle, sarka, a wheeled carriage, a gun carriage, a cart. Arka, copper, gold. Eraka, metal infusion. Virundeshwara pillar is the most striking object standing in the village of Ballygavi. This pillar on a crossroad, where it stands in its full majesty, is a huge pillar, about 9 meters high, has its base enclosed by a small structure. It is raised over a two-tier platform of about 3 meters high. Now known as the Garuda Kamba, this pillar was originally erected to support a lifelike statue of Gandaberunda. This pillar was erected by Mahamandaleshwara Chamunda Raya Rasa in 1047 Common Era when he was ruling over Banavasi Santalige Highway. Chamunda Raya Rasa was under the service of a Kalyana Chalukya king, Someshwara. The inscription mentions that this pillar was erected in front of God Jagada Kamaleshwara. Jagadeka Malleshwara. God Jagadeka Malleshwara would have been set up by the Chamunda Raya Rasa, as also known by the title Jagadeka Malla. No remains of this temple survive except the singular pillar standing tall. The statue of Gandaberunda is no more on the top of the pillar. It's kept inside the enclosure on which the pillar is standing. It's kept in a locked gate. Gandaberunda represents a mythological bird having half bird and half human body. Look at the picture. Absolute stunner. The legend of Gandaberunda. Lord Vishnu assumed the avatar of Narasimha, half man, half beast, to slay demon Hiranyakashipu. In this avatar, became so omnipotent that the benevolent divinities began to fear of total destruction. Hence, they prayed to Lord Shiva. Shiva then assumed the form of Sharaba, the mythical bird, and tamed Narasimha, man-lion. Vishnu then transformed himself to Gandaberunda and faced Sharaba. Gandaberunda thus came to be known as the symbol of immense power. Later, this mighty mythical bird was adopted as the emblem of several rulers. Even today, the Gandaberunda symbol, the double eagle symbol, is representing sovereignty, even in Russia. There is a phenomenal representation of the same double eagle on a stone pier of Sphinx Gate at Alaka Huyuk. The double eagle is grasping two hairs in Alaka Huyuk, sometimes referred to as Alaka Huyuk, Araja Huyuk, Yuk, Yuk. This is the site of a Neolithic Hittite settlement and is an important archaeological site. It is situated in Alaka Koram province, Turkey, northeast of Bogaskale, formerly and more familiarly Bogaskai, where the ancient capital city Hattusa of the Hittite Empire was situated. The mound Turkish Huyuk at Alka Huyuk was a scene of settlement in a continuous sequence of development from the Chalcolithic age, when the earliest copper tools appeared alongside the use of stone tools. During the early Bronze Age, the mound was the center of nourishing, flourishing Hattian culture. It has been continuously occupied ever since until today's modern settlement in the form of a small village. The standing and distinguishing remains at Alka Huyuk, however, such as the Sphinx Gate, date from the Hittite period that followed the Hatti from the 14th century before Common Era. 13 shaft-graved royal tombs, approximately 2500 before Common Era in Alka Huyuk, contained the dead in a fetal position facing south. They were richly adorned with gold fibulae, diadems, belt buckles, and repose gold leaf figures. According to Trevor Bryce, there is a theory that the occupants of the tombs were not from the native Hattian population of central Anatolia, but were Kurgan immigrants from the region of Maikop in southern Russia. Also spoke Indo-European language and perhaps became rulers of the local Hattian population. I suggest a hypothesis that these people were the Meluha merchants who were traveling all over Europe and Russia, spreading their metallurgical competence. So look at the rock sanctuary of Yazilikia of approximately 13th century before Common Era, which shows the double-headed eagle and two hairs in the claws of this eagle. What do they represent? They are indescript hieroglyphs. Kara, hair. Kar, blacksmith. Siena, eagle. Asani, thunderbolt. Ahangar, blacksmith. Ahan, iron. Ahangar, smith, blacksmith. Ahangar in Kashmiri, a blacksmith. So Siena, Ahangar. Same Gandaberunda, the Siena, is a roof sculpture in Rameshwara temple in Keladi. Keladi is a temple town in Sagara Taluk, Shimoga district of the state of Karnataka, India, also close to Sahyadri Ranges, close to Belgaum. Look at the picture. The eagles are so powerful, so represent such enormous power, that they can lift up an elephant and another animal on its claws and fly away with those tributes. The same double-headed eagle appears in Takshashila, Sirkap, the right wing of the stereo bait of the shrine of the double eagle in block F of Sirkap. The sculptures are from left to right, a Greek-style gabled temple, an Indian-style chaitya-like facade surmounted with a double-headed eagle bird, and an Indian-style torana-like gate. Each partitioning pilaster has a Greek Corinthian capital. There are no other objects that show the character of the Gandharan art more plainly, the encounter and the mixture of cultures of the East and the West. It's a magnificent document called a Triple Eagle Temple, Gandabherunda, Siena Chiti, Siena. This was a very major wealth contributor to the wealth of Bharatam, because the richest iron ore in the world, the magnetite ore and the hematite ore, come from India. We'll now look back, just pause and take a look at the wealth of the nation prepared by a brilliant Cambridge historian called Angus Madison. When the European Union was about to be formed, he gave this memorandum and this pie chart recommending the constitution of European Union, the way the Janapadas in India were constituted as guilds put together as Mahajanapadas. In this chart, it is seen that in one common era, Bharatam, the ancient India, accounted for 33% of the world GDP. 33%. China accounted only for 25%. So India was the richest nation on the globe as of one common era. The principal wealth of the nation was related to minerals, metals, alloys, ceramic castings, apart from the know-how of herbals, cotton, silk fabrics, and producers of farm and forest products. So this inquiry, which is repeatedly mentioned in the Rigveda Richas, is promoted further in Arthashastra, the wealth science of Kautilya, which inquires on how the ancient India contributed to creation of wealth of nations. So we have to depend upon our ancient texts to reconstruct the economic history of Bharatam Janam. Bharatam Janam is an expression used by Vishwamitra in the Rigveda. Vishwamitrasya rakshati brahmedam Bharatam Janam. That's how he says. This Brahma, this mantra of Vishwamitra will protect the people of Bharata. Bharatam Janam. Let us take a look at some components of wealth. Annam, roots of rice cultivation. Annam, boiled rice in Rigveda. Veda. Annam. According to Yaska, Adayate, Atti, Cha, Bhutani, Anam, Abhi, Mukhena, Henanna, Prahavi, Bhutam, Bhavati, Bhojanaya, Bhutanam. Food in general is called Annam. Aham Annam, Bhavan, Bhukta, I am your prey. Charanam, Charanam, Annam, Acharava. Food is representing the lowest form in which the Supreme Soul is manifested, being the coarsest and the last of the five vestures, kosha, in which the soul is clothed and passed from body to body in the long process of metempsychosis. The materialized vesture or visible body in the world of sense, sthula sarira, annamaya kosha. Boiled rice, annena vyanjanam, bread corn, Annam Asurjanta. So this is the map of the last glacial era, approximately 20,000 before common era, when the rice cultivation was continued in India because it was not affected by the ice age right up to the early Holocene, 9,000 before common era, before present. So wild rice cultivation in comparison to the recent populations is indicated by crosses and circles on this map. The agricultural evidence clearly relates to early cultivation in Bharat, particularly on the eastern parts closer to Southeast Asia, the Mekong Delta, the Irrawaddy Salween Deltas, Brahmaputra Delta, Ganga Yamuna Deltas. We have seen the evidence of a Kalibangan ploughed field dated to 3rd millennium BCE, contrasted with the modern field where very clearly the furrows are drawn and cross furrows are drawn to indicate how, together with rice, other cereals also will be cultivated depending upon the monsoon seasons. There is evidence archaeologically attested of cultivated field and rice produced from these fields. Earth resource of water was remarkably managed. We have seen the evidence of a profile of a Gavarband, a grand aniket, on the Sindhu River at Mehrgarh. Similar Gavarbands existed, and the Gavarband became a model for the Kallanai, which bifurcated Kaveri into Kaveri and Kollidam, creating an additional cultivable area of 5 lakh acres of land. Water management system using these Gavarbands. Gavarbands are just only stone barriers, like the Grand Aniket, stone barriers, Aniket, which split the water flow into two channels. This is a map of river Kaveri breaking up into two segments of Kaveri and Kollidam near Srirangam, near Tiruchirappalli. This is the map of the Grand Aniket where the water overflows and bifurcates into two channels. Kaveri waters from the flowing into faster and steeper Kollidam, Kolruvan it's called, allowing for a much larger region to receive the waters of the Kaveri for irrigation. As I mentioned, the additional area created was 5 lakh acres of land, additional wet land and rich alluvial soil on the Kaveri basin. So this is a map which shows how the Aniket bifurcated the river flow into two segments, the Kaveri segment and the Kollidam segment, and the, both the flows are kept apart. So the divided area is covered by the irrigation channels. So this is how the wealth was created. Effective management of water systems, and those water systems of variety of kinds. We have evidence from the civilization of circular stone wells of Dholavira and stormwater drains in the castle, leading to one of the reservoirs. The intention was clearly to capture every drop of rainfall. Look at the reservoir. It's huge, 73 meters by 29 meters. It also had a stepped well at the bottom, which also stored water. So water was a major resource together with the land for achieving the wealth of the nation. And the reservoir stored the water in periods when there were no rainfall, and they were using the stored water for cultivation in cultivable seasons. Look at the rock cut reservoir, 33 meters by 9 meters. Number of reservoirs in Dholavira. Secondary reservoir, 15.5 meters to 5.5 meters at the bottom. Underground drain connecting to the two reservoirs, ensuring equalization of levels and a better distribution. But look at the brilliance that was achieved in engineering architecture of controlling and managing water. Samples of wells, drainage sluices of Harappa. So this gave rise to another industry, the textiles industry. Cotton is attested, cotton cultivation is attested, spinning is attested, weaving is attested. Silk also was known at that point in time because silk thread was seen together with the bead, with a copper bead. The thread was a silk thread. That is what this Harappa exploration brought out by the HARP team from Harvard University. Look at that old lady working at the spinning wheel, the charka, sark wheel, producing cotton thread. And the thread ends up, we have seen the pictures of the cotton fibers of local brown cotton, unbleached. Then they are also dyed. Spindle wools of terracotta have been found in Harappan settlements, testifying to the spinning of cotton. In addition, minute fragments of dyed woven cotton were found attached to silver vase at Mohenjo-daro, one of the two earliest known examples of cotton in the world. In fact, Sindhan means cotton. Sindhu river, Sindhan, Hindon. In Sindhu, Hindu. This was the source of cotton textile for the world. Indian civilization, the ancient Indian Hindu civilization, Saraswati Sindhu civilization, was the clothier of the world, supplying extremely sophisticated fibers and clothing in cotton and silk. Evidence of weaving is also seen in clay impressions on clay, which are used as packaging material. Now the spinning, and if it is complemented by weaving, very simple techniques of sophisticated hand looms. Here is an example of a pit from Orissa, not from civilization times, but you can only guess on because of the wood that was used, which might have disappeared over a period of time. You can see how it was used with using very simple technologies. So we have evidence of the textiles of cotton and silk. The unique discovery of a coiled copper alloy wire necklace dating to 2450 before Common Era is the earliest evidence of silk in South Asia. So there is a dispute that is going on whether the silk came from China first or from Bharat first. It appears it was from Bharat, Saraswati Sindhu civilization. Microscope analysis of the thread fragments conclusively proved that the silk fibers were used for purpose of making these silk threads. So this renders obsolete the established view that the sericulture was an exclusive Chinese technique. Indians also were experts in Banarasi saris, Kanchipuram saris, silk saris. Then let us look at other resources. Copper deposits of South Asia and adjacent regions. The copper regions were the richest in the world. That contributed to the tin bronze revolution. We have seen the wealth of nations. We have seen how the wealth of ancient Bharat comprised of iron ore resources, of variety of iron, hematite, magnetite, laterite. We have seen the resources of the fields, agriculture, rice, cereals. We have seen the resources of cotton and textiles and silk textiles. Now we will see another major resource, copper deposits, which powered the tin bronze revolution of the 4th millennium BC all over Europe. And this has been proved by a brilliant analysis by a group of scientists who did archaeometallurgical provenance analysis of the copper that was used in producing the bronze objects in Europe, and they found 90% of the resource was supplied from the Kaithiri mines near Gujarat and Rajasthan along the Saraswati River basin. So this is the map. This accounted for the copper deposits from India servicing the tin bronze revolution. As we said, tin was an important additive to copper to create bronze. Copper itself was very malleable. It had to be hardened. So tin was added to create an alloy called bronze, which created a virtual revolution of creating hardware, weapons, equipment, plowshares, sickles and so on, which made life of a civilization emerge out of the Neolithic age, the Copper Age, Stone Age. So here is the picture of an ancient smithy at work, copper smelting furnace at Kaithiri, 19th century British report from Ambaji in Gujarat. Perhaps a similar smithy and forge existed in Oman. Copper sources of Kaithiri mines and Iran Baluchistan, Bactria Margiana archaeological complex were used in these smithies and forges. So this is a good series of slides prepared by James Conoyer together with the students of IIT Gandhinagar, Gujarat, showing how Ambaji near Gujarat provided for varieties of pyrites, copper pyrites, iron pyrites, and resources of copper metal. So the resources were used. This is how the storage was recorded. Malachite, azurite. And then the students of the IIT Gandhinagar tried to recreate the old technologies using the Ambaji copper slag. and ore collected, and they try to process it, trying to mirror the technologies of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization times. How they separated one metal from another, from copper, from iron, and so on. And the types of articles and beads that were created using these furnaces. Even glass technology was perfected in the second half of the second millennium, and it spread all over India to create glass bangles, for example. And beads and bangles from Uttar Pradesh are seen on this picture. And the beautiful beads, jewelry, they were grounded, grinding, they were pierced through, they were polished, they were drilled with fine holes, carnelian beads were used, agates, even lapis lazuli from Afghanistan, and ernstite mineral was used to even drill through diamonds and very hot stones. Precious stones, semi-precious stones were effectively created, were used to create the wealth of jewelry items, lapidary work, gems and jewels. They also contributed to wealth because they were in great demand. So there was a trade activity created for these resources. So there we are referring to Navaratna, nine precious gems, diamond, Mukta, pearl, Manikya, ruby, Indranila, sapphire, Vajra, diamond, Marakata, emerald, Vidruma, coral, Gomeda, jacinth, Pushparaga, topaz, Vaidurya, lapis lazuli. So these are all the Navaratna, nine gems. They also were used as a metaphor for the nine poets in the Mauryan Empire, Navaratnas. This list of nine gems appears in classical texts. There are a number of gems, go up number 36 types of gems. All of the above minerals have been documented in the archaeological record. Perfect evidence of sources of wealth that were used effectively by the artisans and skilled workers, lapidaries, smiths, metalsmiths, smelters, who used this material and created beautiful works of art and jewelry that was in great demand. They also used chemical practices, included pottery, prolonged heating, fusion, evaporation, treatment of minerals and pigments, metalworking with gold, copper, bronze, tin, brass, lead, silver, iron, zinc, preparation of mortar and cement, limestone, gypsum and their modified forms, preparation of fermented juices, extract of essential oils, production of pigments for dyeing, production of treatment of glass. So these are the technological framework created by artisans. So artisans are a source of wealth. As you have seen, land, labor is a very important component of wealth creation. Land, labor. Indian practice of alchemy. The beauty was, the experimentation was done, inquiry was done as to the properties of matter by combining minerals, combining metals. Chemistry cum alchemy was the rasa shastra, rasa vidya, or dhatu vada. Rasa means essence, taste, sap, juice, semen, nectar, also mercury. In esoteric symbolism was mercury as the male principle of Shiva, sulfur as the female principle of Shakti. It's a metaphor. In interplay with tantrism, in Chinese alchemy, mercury is the female and sulfur is male. Transmuting the base metals into gold and pursuit of the elixir of life appears in India around the 5th century common era of the Gupta age. This is the source of alchemy. Rasavidya became alchemy studies in course of time. Of transportation of material, transportation of metals. Mercury is seen as the divine of the alchemical practices, operations and processes. It is believed to bestow occult powers, including invisibility. Mercurial preparations are said to give long life and youthful vigor. As a result, some Ayurvedic and Siddha medicines are mercury-based but undergo complex processes so as to reach non-toxic mercury compounds. Look at the number of mercury compounds that were created which are non-toxic. Very impressive alchemical competence, chemical competence in working with materials. This is the source of wealth of the country. when artisans continue to inquire into creation of new material and to understanding the properties of matter, properties of these metals and minerals, and see what happens when combinations of these into alloys creates new material with new characteristics and new features which are of immense use. For example, you can make a lightweight aluminium for creating aircraft. It can fly up into the air. Solid material, they can also be used for making, amputing the legs, broken legs, using light material for people to walk after they have been incapacitated by some injury or whatever. And there are all brilliant terms available in the Meluha, Samskritam, Prakritam words, 18 words that are listed here. Very impressive. Metallurgical, chemical competence of the ancient Indians. Then there are examples of the tantras, yantras that were used for processing this material. And each of these mechanisms had a special name, such as Koshti Yantra, Dola Yantra, Adhana Yantra, Dhupa Yantra. Some producing only fumes, some even doing transportation using sublimation. Then absorption of vapor into liquids, conversion into liquids, storing them as liquids, sublime. Then fumigation of gold leaves or silver, and fumes of sulfur, other substances. They also understood that fumes can create carbon, a new element. For example, a wheat chaff was put into a ring called chashala. It was set into fire, and the fumes entered into the molten metal to create hardened steel. Iron became steel because carbon entered the ferrous oxide and created steel. A particular 3% of carbon is added to it. How it is added? By putting on fire the wheat chaff, converted into a ring on top of a pillar. Chashala, Yupa Chashala. We have examples of the technologies of textiles and dyeing, spindle wars and all that we have seen earlier, a technological component of wealth. Then there are living traditions of smelting of the agarias, which continue even today. Their technologies are brilliant. They are workers with iron and production of steel. They are the agarias in Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Bastar. There are also metal workers in South India, in Hyderabad, in Kiradi, and a number of other sites in South India. There was iron and steel working that was going on. And a metal called zinc was recognized. It required very specialized equipment for proper sublimation because it is a very low melting point. They were able to crack the problem, and an industrial scale operation was evidenced archaeologically in these zinc mines of Rajasthan. Zinc metallurgy in ancient India, the credit goes to the complex metallurgy and production of alloys. Metallurgical skill of the metal workers and artisans of ancient India, way back centuries before the common era. Such good understanding of the metallurgical procedures as involved metallurgy of zinc may also be a pointer to the overall expertise of the Indian artisans who possessed fine behavior, understood the fine behavior of the specific minerals of the antiquity. So when you add zinc to copper, it becomes brass. When you add tin to copper, it becomes bronze, bell metal. Damascus steel was produced. Ukku steel was produced by adding carbon into molten metal. So the types of smelters have also been found in an archaeological setting. Earliest kiln for copper smelting was traced at Lothal. The kiln or furnaces used for smelting copper ingots in earthen bowls was a very simple circular and brick structure, about 0.8 meters diameter and 0.6 meters deep. That's it. Smelting furnaces in ancient India. Zinc is signified by the symbol swastika. Sattva, jasta means swastika symbol. Sattva means zinc. Sattva added to copper can produce pewter. So sattva also means pewter. Sattva, jasta, swastika. So swastika was a symbol that was used in Indus-Crypt seals. 50 seals have been found with only with swastika, right turning, right, left turning. So this was not invented by Hitler. It was invented by our ancient Indian civilization artisans who were working with zinc. Swastika signified zinc as a material wealth resource. Look at the seals. Swastika, 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 swastika. Then there's a 5 swastikas are shown together. Tattal means 5. Tattar means a brass worker. Tattar. Tattara. Brass worker. 5 swastikas. So he was adding zinc to copper to create brass. Almost like gold shining. Gold-like material was created. So it was considered very important component. So swastika became a very sacred symbol, which would be highlighted on even temple walls. So there is a seal that has been deciphered. H-182 tablet from Harappa with 5 swastika symbols and 3 text messages, 3 hieroglyphs together with a tiger and a drummer. Kola is a tiger. Kol is iron worker. A drummer is dole. Dul means metal caster. So he was using serapeutic technique for purpose of creating bronze and brass sculptures like the dancing girls of Mohenjo-daro. So we have got another swastika together with the tree. Tree also is an Indus-Crypt hieroglyph. Kuti is a tree. Kuti means a smelter. We have seen crocodile and fish. Crocodile is Kara. Kara means blacksmith, car. Aya means fish. Aya means iron. Ayas means alloy metal. Ayaskara, alloy metal smith. Metal smith working with zinc in a smelter and produced, documented it as that rim of the jar symbol shows Karanaka. Karana, accountant, scribe, helmsman of a boat, a boatman. So that symbol signified that he was producing the material using zinc in his mithi as a cargo, as a shipment for ancient Far East. He's a seafaring merchant. Sattva. Glyph. Satavu, pewter and zinc. Swastika becomes a symbol of the Indus-Crypt. Satya, variety of pronunciations in Meluha. See, Meluha was signified by Mlecha, where the pronunciation was not very perfectly followed. That is one of the reasons why in some ancient texts, Mlecha referred to as bad pronouncers. Because in a ritual involving a sacred function of the Yajna, you are supposed to express the words very precisely. So you are supposed to learn how to pronounce grammatically, correctly, and pronounce correct pronunciation. But in the common parlance, in the Meluha speech, varieties of dialects are developed. So they had a variety of forms. For example, Sattva became Satya, Satyo, Satya, Swastika. So this variety occurred. Satavu means pewter and zinc. So they are recorded in the Indian lexicons. Jasta, it becomes, Swatva becomes Jasta in Hindi. Jastuvu, made of zinc or pewter. Satavu, Satavu, Sattu, pewter, zinc. So it's adding an element which made the mineral of copper meaningful. It added essence of metallic function for copper. Dosta is zinc in Santali. Jasada, Yasada, Yasadaska, Yasatva. There are varieties of pronunciations of the same word, sattva, zinc. The other words used for zinc are Rughitutiya, Tutta, Arthasastra. Totamu, Tutanag, Tutanag, or Ikalkos in Greek. So this is how the language evolution takes place. A new product has been found. They tried to name it and it followed. So the original naming was done by the Meluha merchants and Meluha artisans who created these metal artifacts and originated the idea of this metal, which can be effectively used as an additive for creating a useful alloy. They are so signified on a number of Indus-Crypt inscriptions. Look at the number of times it is shown the swastika together with the elephant. Elephant is Iba, It means iron. Swastika, sattva, sattva, zinc and pewter, and so on. So every one of these elements of field symbols, the pictorial motifs of animals, and a person sitting in front of a tree and so on, they all signified India's Indus-script hieroglyphs. A tiger is shown as looking back, kamara, to look back, kamar, blacksmith, kola, tiger, kolhe, smelter, kol, kolan, working in iron, heraka, spy, heraka, molten cast copper, metal infusion, kuti, tree, kuti, smelter, konda, a stalk or stump of, in Marathi, a leafless tree, kondar, turner, in Bengali, kondo, to turn in a lathe, sattva, jasta, zinc, iba, elephant, iba, iron, ibo, merchant, kariba, rank of elephant, reba, skarba, iron. So, iron, zinc, pewter, copper, molten copper, metal infusion, they are all being represented as wealth resources on these Indus-script inscriptions. So we can very conclusively say that out of these 9,000 inscriptions, most of them relate to wealth accounting ledgers created by these accountants and scribes who recorded their wealth creating activities and how the wealth of nation was created. So we have got documentation available today which can enable us to rewrite the economic history of the country from 7th millennium before Common Era to today, to one Common Era when Angus Madison found that India accounted for 33% of the world GDP. So India was a superpower in terms of the wealth resources. It controlled a tremendous amount of materials and resources which were of incredible value for the civilizations of the neighboring regions and also the Indian civilization. So this is the details of the decipherment of each of the components, which can be very carefully gone through. This is a map which shows the sources of tin, because tin was so important. See, bronze originally was made of arsenical bronze, which was a naturally occurring alloy. It was a natural resource. But arsenical alloy became a short supply. But some guy invented the idea of adding tin to copper to create the same bronze. So tin bronze revolution it is called, from the 4th millennium. So this tin bronze revolution was facilitated by a very major tin resource, which happens to be the largest tin belt of the globe, which is on the banks of the Himalayan rivers of the Mekong, Irrawaddy, Salween. These Himalayan rivers flowing down for 2,500 kilometers grind down the granite rocks and create cassiterite tin ore deposits on the river banks of these Mekong, Irrawaddy, Salween rivers. So this ancient forest was the major source of tin, and Indian merchants and Indian artisans were the intermediaries. So this tin ore from the ancient forest moved along the Indian Ocean and along the navigable waterways of Mekong, Irrawaddy, Salween, Brahmaputra, Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Persian Gulf, all over Europe. So this ancient maritime tin route created a facility whereby tin from Hanoi in Vietnam could be taken up to Haifa in Israel. That has been found archaeologically in a shipwreck with three tin ingots, which were written with inscription in Indus-script. That is a tin resource. So there is a maritime tin route of 3rd millennium before Common Era from the Far East to the Fertile Crescent. Tin belt of the world is in the Far East. Dongshan bronze drums made in these regions of Mekong Delta and Irrawaddy Salween Deltas attest to the fact use of Sirapadu casting method and use of Indus-script hieroglyphs on these drums. Eurasia's demand for tin to make tin bronzes because of the scarcity of arsenical copper. Maritime tin route supplied tin through seafaring merchants of Meluha, Bharatam Janam. So Bharatam Janam were the intermediary agents, marketing agents for marketing this tin resource for the world. That is the revolution. So the tin bronze revolution was mediated by Bharatam Janam, the artisans of Bharat. So this is the, look at the map of the Hindu Mahasagar area, Parivar, Malay tin granite belt, and the hieroglyphs on the tin bronze tympanums of the Dongsong and Karen bronze drums, and the accumulation of tin ore and prospecting for ore. They are just like nodules, like prospecting for gold, you prospect for tin, tin stones, cassiterite stones. So look at this picture of the Karen bronze drum. Elephant is shown, peacock is shown, tiger is shown. They are all indescript hieroglyphs, which refer to the work of the metalsmiths of the ancient Far East. And the ancient Far East received the Meluha merchants, Meluha artisans, and transferred their language to Mon Khmer. University of Hawaii linguists have proved that the Meluha language of Santal Paraganas, the Mundarika, Austroasiatic languages resulted in Mon Khmer languages in Vietnam. So the source for Mon Khmer was Meluha, Mundari, Ho, Santal Paragana languages. So Dongson Bronze Drum hieroglyphs, Arka Sun, Eraka Morton Cast, Ranku Antelope, Ranku Tin, Mendaka Frog, Mid Iron, Muka Frog, Muh Ingot, Karando Duck, Karata, a large aquatic bird, Karada, hard alloy from iron, silver, etc. Kanga, Kumbing, Kang, Brazier, Karado, Karikomb, Karadi, Turner, Kanka, Heron, Kang, Kanger, Brazier, Fireplace, Peacock, Maraka, Marakaka, Marka, Loha, Copper Alloy, Kariba, Iba, Elephant, Strung, Elephant, Karba, Iron, Iba, Elephant, Ib, Iron. So now we can see the source of tin, the cassiterite ore, became a very important component in creating wealth resource of the nation as a trading nation of the world at that point in time. So the tin belt of the globe is signified by a Paramahamsa, the flying bird, Anser indicus, which travels across the Himalayas from Serbia and settles down in Assam, in South India and in Rajasthan. So Indian Ocean maritime routes have been well documented from the ancient Far East through Sri Lanka, through the eastern and western ports of India, through the Persian Gulf and through the Red Sea, Suez Canal into Egypt. So the entire Europe was supplied by these ancient maritime tin routes. So we have a phenomenal story to tell. Dholavira to Uruk was an integral segment of the ancient maritime tin route. So Gujarat was a central point where the so-called Sindhi merchants were there working together with these Kachis, with these Gujarati traders, ancient Indian traders, Meluha traders, transferring the material, putting on top of the tin ingots the impressions of the inscriptions, signifying that they are Ranku Dhatu Muha, which are being supplied. And we will also see the evidence for these ingots that were found in a shipwreck in Haifa, as we cover the next topics. So the phenomenal Uruk Kultepe, from Dholavira to Uruk, Uruk to Kultepe, to Anatolia, the trade routes have been very clearly drafted. So we are able to reconstruct an ancient maritime trade route from Hanoi to Kultepe in Anatolia, which predated the Silk Road by 2 millennia. This beautiful maritime trade route explains how the Indian wealth was created and India became one of the richest nations of the world, superpower of the world. From Assur, it went to Kultepe. Assurs were also Meluha people, we'll see in course of time as we go through some of the examples of indescript inscriptions on both Indus seals and cylinder seals of Mesopotamia. So we have the network of resources drawn up very well by James Conoyer and Randall Law, showing the resources that are used effectively across long distances using the maritime seafaring waterways of the river Saraswati, river Sindhu, Brahmaputra, Ganga, Yamuna. The network of resources covered the eastern India, which accounted for the transactions related to tin. Banga refers to lead and tin, that becomes Banga, Bengal, Bangladesh. There were major transactions in lead and tin from this area through Brahmaputra, through Ganga and Yamuna into Saraswati civilization area. So the resource networks, courtesy Randall Law and James Conoyer, present a comprehensive picture of the wealth resources that were used effectively by the artisans and seafaring merchants of the Saraswati Sindhu civilization from 4th millennium BC of the Tin Bronze Revolution. Now we will see quickly some other resources works and the Gajanapada clusters related to the people who are supplying this material. So the supplies of material came from all parts of India. It is not restricted to the copper belt of Kaithari mines alone. They came from Dharwad, iron, hematite, laterite sources. They came from Bhubaneswar. They came from Puri. They came from Bengal. The tin came from the ancient Far East. So there was a network of resources which covered both India and the ancient Far East. Here are two brilliant maps. One shows the Bronze Age sites of both the ancient Far East and India, which are Northeast India. And another map which shows the language structure of the Austroasiatic languages and the Mon Khmer languages. There is complete correlation between the Bronze Age sites and the Austroasiatic language sites. So which very clearly demonstrates the correctness of the interpretation by the University of Hawaii linguist scholars that the Mon Khmer languages were derived from Mundarika, Austroasiatic languages, Santali from Santal Paraganas. So the Iron Age also dates from about 1800 before Common Era on the Ganga Plain. That has been demonstrated by Tiwari, who discovered also an iron smelter. So the Iron Age argument is demolished. Iron was continuing to be used even during the Bronze Age. That has been very clearly established in a very brilliant article by George Purcell. We can explain now how Purushottama presents a Ukku sword to Alexander on the Vitastha Jhelum River. This is a painting from the Steel Authority of India Limited Institute, which shows the picture of a smithy at work and the beautiful swords, which are also celebrated on coins of ancient India. So did Alexander defeat Porus? That's a historical question that's got to be examined further by historical researchers. Thank you very much. Namaskaram.